you please stand, please, as we begin our worship together?
You noticed we're a little empty over here. There's a reason. A big shout out to Isaac Bush, son of April Bush, grandson of Joanne James. He's being baptized down at Gordonsville Baptist, so all of his faithful buddies and family are down there supporting him in that big day. So I hope Isaac gets to see this. Way to go, Isaac. Also, if you can keep little Asher Reed, Jesse and Dylan's little boy, in prayer. He's having tubes put in Tuesday. So we just want to make sure that he's safe and cared for in the Father's hands. One more quick thing. If you did anything at all yesterday, whether it was attend, cook food, serve people, be a good host, hug people, love Dana, thank you for what you did. Ran around like a stepchild, like poor Tucker had to. anything that yesterday... I thank you. Anna would have loved it. And so on that note, let us do our call to worship this morning, and then we'll pray, and then we'll go from there. We are branches rooted in the vine of Christ. The branches that remain in the vine bear much fruit. If we abide in Christ, then Christ's words will abide in us because we strive to be faithful disciples. We gather for worship now to the glory of the one God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. May we grow wildly as God tends to us lovingly. Let me pray. Let us pray. Almighty God, we come to you today so thankful to have a God that creates, nurtures, sustains, and calls us child. We are God's beloved child of whom he is well pleased, and we should never forget that no matter what the world tells us. We love you, Lord, and we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who gave us this connection to you in such a mighty way. We thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit, who gives us a fire of passion within us to love you more deeply and love others more deeply. Lord, we know that that's the same Spirit that raised your Son, Jesus Christ, from the dead, and that is a mighty power that resides within those of us who love you. Lord, we thank you that we were taught things by Jesus. And one of the things we were taught was a prayer that he shared with his friends. Let us now pray that prayer by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We are a child of God. He makes that available to all of us.
And we are his child because he came as our Savior. He gave us an opportunity to be his. We're going to sing a hymn now. It's a little bit older than the one you just sang. It's called Jesus, What a Friend for Sinners. And the words really spoke to me this week, particularly the second verse that you'll sing in a moment. It says, Jesus, what a strength in weakness. Let me hide myself in him. Still speaking to me. Tempted, tried, sometimes failing. He, my strength, my victory wins. It's not on us, y'all. He's done it. He's done it.
Amen.
He's our friend, and we're going to sing that song. And y'all gonna have to help me.
Friends, we pray.
Seated. If my ushers could please come forward as we receive God's tithes and our offerings. We gathered a graduate confirmand because we didn't have all of our seven here yet this morning. They'll meet us for confirmation, so we wanted to use the confirmands, but thank you for being a willing victim, so we appreciate it. If you'll pray with me, please. Almighty God, we are so incredibly thankful for people who will serve. I'm thankful for a belief system that we can go be with others in their place and space when they're celebrating their love for you and come back, and that it just makes it even better. Lord, we love you. We praise you. And we thank you for all the gifts from above. We thank you for all the ability you give us. And we know that apart from you, we have and are nothing. And we ask you today to, out of gratitude, let us give back a portion of that which you've given to us. Magnify and glorify all of these gifts that come forward so that they may enhance the ministries of this church as we reach out to the people beyond the walls and within the walls. Amen. Stand, please. My faithful.
Our scripture this morning is taken from Jeremiah, two selections, and then John. Now this is what the Lord says, "Sing with joy for Israel, shout for the greatest of nations, shout out with praise and joy, save your people, O Lord, the remnant of Israel. For I will bring them from the north and from the distant corners of the earth. I will not forget the blind and lame, the expected mothers, and the women in labor. A great company will return. Tears of joy will stream down their faces, and I will lead them home with great care. They will walk beside quiet streams, and on smooth paths they will not stumble. For I am Israel's father, and Ephraim is my oldest child." Continuing Jeremiah 30, verse 31, "The day is coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and Judah. This covenant will be like the one I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand and brought them out of the land of Egypt. They broke that covenant, though I love them as a husband loves his wife, says the Lord. But this is the new covenant that I made with the people of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my instructions deep within them, and I will write them on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they will be my people." Now, continuing in the Gospel of John, these words, "I have loved you even as the Father has loved me. Remain in my love. When you obey my commandments, you remain in my love, just as I obey my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you these things so that you will be filled with my joy. Yes, your joy will overflow. This is my commandment, love each other in the same way I have loved you. There is no greater joy than to lay down one's life for one's friend. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you slaves because a master doesn't confide in his slaves. Now you are my friends since I have told you everything that Father has told me. You didn't choose me, but I chose you. I appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit so that the Father will give you whatever you ask for using my name. This is my command, love each other." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
I'm kind of glad y'all are going down there. It won't look so empty on this side. I should have made y'all sit over there. In case you haven't noticed, Nicole's not going to have children's church today because we don't have very many children. So what that means, let me say this, those of you that don't have kids, if the kids get a little wiggly, help their mamas. Don't turn around and give them judgy eyes. Help them. That's what family does. Don't get mad if they're kicking the back of your seat. Just smile at them and help them out. So will you pray with me and for me, please? Loving God, we come today, this morning, to hear this message that you've prepared for us. Make our hearts fertile. Make our minds open, ready to receive. Our ears wide open, ready to hear. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be found pleasing and acceptable to you on this day and always, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. So when we lived in Crossville for a really long time before the first church I ever had to move into a parsonage, and I didn't grow up liking apples. Now, you guys got to remember, I'm a city girl. So we didn't have homegrown stuff. You know, we bought everything at the grocery store. And apples don't taste the same from a grocery store as they do from an orchard. And in Crossville, as many of you know, because I've brought apples here from there, there's a Rouse apple orchard, and they have amazing apples. All of their apples are very good, but, you know, which ones do I like? Honeycrisp. But I liked them all. And I did not know apples could be that good. Fun fact, I didn't know tomatoes could be that good either when you grow them on the vine. It's amazing, right? So anyway, when my first church that I served that had a parsonage was in Cookeville, and I was never so excited when I looked out across the backyard and I saw an apple tree. Because you see, I had never had a fruit tree in a yard that I lived in. And I was excited because I wasn't going to have to drive to Crossville to get apples. They would be right there. I could just walk out my back door and grab an apple. So once we got a little bit, some of the stuff moved in and everything, first thing I did was go to that apple tree. Now, they were green. It was July. But I like kind of a green apple sometimes, especially if they're a Granny Smith. And so I looked around and found one that looked the best, plucked it off the tree, took one bite. That was the nastiest thing I have ever tasted. Not the nastiest apple, one of the nastiest things in general I've ever tasted. And I might have even tried a couple more apples to see if I got a bad one, but I didn't. They were all bad. And so, of course, guess who gets to go back to Crossville to Rouse to get apples? And so I did. And I was talking to Reggie, the owner of the Rouse apple, Reggie Rowell, and I was telling him about this, and he was like, what did the tree look like? Okay, you know how I am with plants. It was a tree. It had leaves, roots, branches. That's my description, right? And I said, okay, wait a minute, I have a picture of my phone, because I was trying to figure it out. And I showed it to him. He goes, those are horse apples. I said, what? And he said, well, I mean, you could probably peel them and cut them up and put enough sugar and spices, you might be able to do something with them, but they're really only fit to feed horses. And I was like, poor horses. But my point being, because we've been talking about if you abide in Christ, the one true vine, you will bear fruit. But if you abide in something else, you will bear fruit. But it will not be the ripe fruit. It will not be Christ fruit. It might be a horse apple fruit. It might be a I work too many hours and I put too much into climbing a ladder fruit. It might be name your thing that you do too much of fruit. It might be I watch too much television fruit. It might be I'm on the internet too much fruit. But your fruit will represent what you're attached to, is what I'm trying to say, what you abide in. And so that's something that you need to think about. It's like, what am I abiding in? Because someone, just like I was attracted to those apples because of their fruit, somebody might be attracted to what fruit that you're producing. And it's not fruit that we really want to pass forward. But when I got the bite of a good apple, my joy was complete. I'm not going to lie. Still to this day, I bite into a Honeycrisp apple, and if it's from a good place, I'm happy. I mean, there is very little joy that compete with that except the joy of Christ. And so it's important that we really give the question today this long thought. What vine am I attached to? Where do I abide? Where do I find myself giving most of my time, my attention, my money, my focus? Where is that place? Because that's where you're abiding, because abiding means staying, right? Being. So whatever that is, then that's the fruit that you will produce. So Jesus, in this section that David just read, is reminding us of our place in this vine when we're attached. Now keep in mind, I've already told you, this is where Jesus is kind of preparing them to be okay when he leaves. They don't really get the whole leaving thing, but he's telling them that. And he's trying to make them be okay for that. And he's trying to give them the tools they will need to continue on once he's gone. But he's also apparently a little worried that they're going to find themselves attaching to a different vine. Now, if you remember the first week, one of the verses was, I am the one true vine. Jesus says that, I'm the one true vine. So if you're not attached to that vine, and you find yourself attached to another vine, you're not attached where you need to be. But he also said that through my words, you've been cleansed or pruned. In other words, just from attaching yourself to Jesus and knowing his teachings and his words and his words of life, that you've already been pruned to produce this beautiful fruit. It's already ready. But this week he goes on to talk about love. And he talks about this circle of love. That's how I picture it. God loved that vine or that son, his beloved son of whom he was well pleased, so much that he just loved him and loved him till he became the true vine. And if we're attached to that, Jesus says, I love you as the Father loves me. So it's a holy love. It's an unconditional love. It's a love with no strings attached. It's a love that gives you grace, forgiveness, mercy, and a joy that you can't find from the world. I mean, worldly joy can be really joyful for a brief period of time. Now, those of you that have ever read a really good book or watched a really great TV show, once those seasons, that season's shows are done, I don't know about you, but I feel a little sad and lost. But while it was on, the joy was there. I mean, it was great, but then I got to wait a whole nother year for Handmaid's Tale to come back or whatever it is. Yes, I watch Handmaid's Tale. I really like it. I've been sad, almost to the point of a little bit of grief at the end of a really good book, or worse yet, a book series, like if there's two or three of a series and I get to the end. You see, the world can give you joy, but it's not lasting joy. And it's not a joy that can make your joy complete or overflowing. It's a temporal joy. It's a temporary joy. And it's not a deep and abiding joy. But he also says, and you're my friends. I call you friends. You're not slaves anymore. You see, when we try so hard to abide to things of the world, we often become slaves to those things. In other words, they inform us how we need to produce in order to get to stay abiding, right? So if you are abiding in your career so that you can move up the ladder, then if that vine, that career vine, informs you how you have to produce, how you have to perform, how you have to live, or you don't get to stay abiding to this vine anymore. You're going to have to go find a different vine. So you're a slave to that somewhat. But when we're talking about abiding to the one true vine of Jesus Christ, we choose that. Because Jesus has said we're no longer slaves. He calls us friends. And I want to make sure that you understand, it's not like a Facebook friend. Joe one time said something, the most profound thing I think I've ever heard. Joe doesn't say much, but when he does, you should listen. And he said, we're talking way back in 2007, you know. He said, those people aren't your friends. They're not your friends if they won't come help you move. Think about that. How many friends you got on your page that would not even come help you move? That's a real thing for Methodist pastors, right? But anyway, he said, Jesus called his disciples. Remember what I told you last week disciples were? They weren't followers. They were people who were attached to the teachings and the life and the living of their master, their rabbi. So that's what these disciples were. They just weren't followers. They were literally trying to become like Jesus. And he called them friends. Now, fun fact, only two other times does God or Jesus call people friends. Moses and Abraham. So for you to be called a friend is huge. For you to be called a friend is big. That's big. And Jesus is saying, if you abide in this, you're my friend. You're no longer a slave. And then he goes into this verse that I'm sure you all have heard, where it says, there is no greater sacrifice than to lay your life down for another. Now, that is the verse I use the most often when I either make Memorial Day videos or I get Memorial Day videos or anything like that. I've been asked to preach at Memorial Day services because that's true. And I believe that about soldiers. They are willing. They know when they join the military that there's a possibility that they're going to have to lay their life down for others, for us, for those of us that are not there fighting as well, or maybe for their brothers that are there fighting. But that's not all this passage means. This passage also means dying to yourself. Like, do you put others first? I often tell people or ask them the question, are you in survival mode or thrival mode? Which is really thriving, but I think it sounds better when you say survival or thrival. Survival mode or thrival. I make up words often, if you haven't figured that out. Survival mode is when you just do what you have to do for yourself to stay out of not being okay. Nobody wants to live like that. That will not complete your joy. That will not make your joy overflowing. And sometimes it will lead you to try to find joy from the world, so at least you get a little temporal happiness. But it goes away. Thriving means that you have sunk so far into the vine that you've got this continual joy, but what it does for you is it makes you die to yourself, and you become less worried about yourself. You become less worried about survival, and you thrive because you are bringing this fruit to others. You become attractive fruit to others, and you know it's good fruit. You're not horse apple fruit. And so dying to yourself, that's what we're looking at. Remember last week I called that navel gazing? When you're so busy looking at what you need, you forget to look up and see what the world needs from you. And bearing this type of fruit means you're attached to the true vine. And the other thing we learned a couple weeks ago was he said, you are cleansed or purified by my words. Remember that? Or pruned. Same word. All the same word. So in other words, once you attach yourself to Jesus, you're purified. You've been given the knowledge, the wisdom, the information to produce the right kind of fruit. You're already able to do that. So I have a cool story. See these two cacti We added these this week, the big tall things. Those of you that know him, these came from Chuck Donath. Now, the story behind them coming from Chuck Donath is really kind of funny. Before he passed, as many of you know, that when he passed, Joe got a lot of the succulents and Lindsay got a lot of the flowers from his greenhouse. Well, in that greenhouse, when he was still healthy, he had like, it was 10, 11 feet tall, one of those, with a lot of things coming off. It was huge, and it was cool. And he looked at Joe one day, and he said, "Do you have a cactus?" And Joe said, "Well, no, I've got like some succulents," which granted, cactuses are succulents, but they're different. Anyway, he says, "Do you have a cactus?" And Joe's like, "No." And I was like, "We can get one." "No." And he grabs his pruning shears that you, clippers that you used on trees. And Chuck wasn't a tall man. And he reached up as high as he could and just chopped the top off of his big tall cactus. And it hit the ground and cactus milk was going everywhere. And he said, "Take that, go plant that." And I was like, "We could have bought one." And he's like, "No, this one's better. I've worked for years to get this one healthy and big and growing." So Joe took it home. And these are products of that cactus. Now, funny, I bought him one at Kroger's. I know, let's see, buying plants at Kroger's. But anyway, I bought him one like this at Kroger's. It died. They had even glued a cactus flower on top of it. Talk about fake attractive fruit, right? So you see that when God is tending the vine, you get good fruit from it. But when the world produces and tends the vine, it's not good. And it will make your joy more complete. And it's not the joy the world gives. And I want to go into this. When you live this way, you're no longer a slave. Why did Jesus use this language with his disciples? As Jews, this would have made sense to them. Because part of their heritage, part of what made them finally see Yahweh for who Yahweh was, God, was when he sent Moses to reach into Egypt and take them out of captivity as slaves. He drew them out of Egypt as slaves because they could not get away from slavery. Now, let's talk about what that meant. When you live with the mind of a slave, okay, when you live with a slave mentality, you only do what people have you do. And you only live the way people will allow you to live. And it is forced upon you. You have no free agency in that decision. Okay? And so God took them out of slavery and then gave them the option to follow God instead of returning back to Egypt. Now, some people didn't go. I don't know if you all know that or not, but not all the Jews left Egypt. They were too scared. They didn't want to go. And what happened when they got in the wilderness when they were freed from slavery? They still wanted to live like slaves. They whined when they didn't have them. There's one verse that says, when we were in slavery, we sat around pots of meat and ate whatever we wanted. Why won't you give us better food, Moses? And then Jesus sent manna and quail. You see, they were stuck in survival mode and they needed to move to a mode of thriving. They needed to quit thinking like slaves. So one of the other things God did was he gave Moses laws. We call them the commandments, by the way. Fun fact, that is not in scripture till you get to the later Old Testament. That was not a word used. It was always laws. And the reason why God used the word laws was because it was a system that people understood. Laws, even today, are created to help a society live better and live better together and live safer. So God used a structure that already existed in their minds and said, here's your laws. Now, I don't know if you've ever taken the time to look at these laws, but the first four are nothing more than telling you how you treat God, this provider. You put him first. You don't have any idols. You remember the Sabbath. Rachel's gone. Vivian, help me. Jennifer, help me. The other one. I can't do this on the fly. I don't know why I didn't write them down. Anyway, those four, first four, how we treat and recognize God as a God who loves us. Last six, not about how you take care of yourself, They're about how you live with others. Don't steal their stuff. Don't take their wife. Don't kill them. Don't lie about them. Honor your father and mother. Not necessarily your father and mother, but the system of family and procreation that was instituted by God is how he got his people to come about. And he gave them those laws because they needed something to take their mind from slave mentality to free man in Christ, in God mentality. And we hear this prophet Isaiah tell these people of Israel who have sin inscribed on their heart so deeply that they can't quite get it right over and over. They just was a revolving door of falling back into sin, but that's what was inscribed on their heart. Slavery was inscribed on their heart. And he says, someday there's going to be a new covenant. And when that new covenant comes, you're going to have my laws inscribed on your heart. Not sin. It's going to erase that, and my laws will be inscribed on your heart. And that's what happened through Christ. Christ and his connection with us to God is the new covenant. That's what the new covenant is. And so what that means is we now have those laws inscribed on our heart. Now, some of you, like, I couldn't even just remember all of them, so there you go. But what that means is you go ask you a two-year-old. Go find you a two-year-old that can have a conversation. Some of them can. And say, are you supposed to kill anything? And you know what they're going to say? No. Even though toddlers are egocentric and they'll take a toy away from somebody, you can say to them, is that yours? No. Were you supposed to take it? No. Those laws are inscribed on our heart. We know. We know what's good. We know what's right. And we have free agency to attach ourselves to that or to something else. And it's our choice. But the sin was replaced by how to love God and love others. I gave you some statistics from a group called Barna last week. I've got some new ones this week that I think you should hear. So they defined a practicing Christian. I love that term because I think we're all practicing at being a Christian all the time, forever. But a practicing Christian is someone who goes to worship service at least a couple times a month. They intently study spiritual studies, a Bible study, a devotional time, something. They read their Bible regularly, and they serve others outside their family, friends, or their church. And that is in their schedule, you know, of life. That's a practicing Christian. So in 2000, 45% of the people in America claimed to be practicing Christians. In 2019, it went down to 25%. And in some of that 25, it was brand new Christians. So that means really there were more. Now, out of those ones that were left, that went away, half of them considered themselves to be Christians but not practicing. In other words, Christians, I call myself a Christian, but I'm not really going to church. Don't really read the Bible. Not really attached to the vine. And then some of them literally left the faith, which is a sermon for another day because I really believe the church is partially responsible for that. But of the new practicing people who identified as Christians, they said that they became that way because of the fruit that attracted them, because of the people who served outside the church, the people who loved outside the church, the people who bore the fruit of Christ out into the world. They saw that, they wanted that, they connected with that, and they began to love Jesus through that. Yesterday, if you were here at Anna's funeral, Anna found Christ at 10 years old. She started writing a book. I don't know if y'all know that. I have the first chapter. It says that in there. But she had to be reintroduced later. And she was reintroduced by one of her first social workers. And she said, and then y'all know she was baptized here. She recommitted here because she found a church family. You see, that's what we're here to do. That's that practicing Christianity outside the walls, outside our family, outside our friends, although Anna was my friend. You see, that's what we're called to do. We're called to produce. That fruit is not being produced for us. It's being produced for others. And you'll bear fruit if you're attached to any vine. But back to the original question, what vine are you attached to? And I've told you this before, but if you want to know, where does your time, talent, money, and energy go? Because that'll tell you what you're attached to. Time, talent, money, and energy. If it's attached to studying, reading, worshiping, serving, you're attached to the right vine. Just think about it. I wasn't always attached to that vine. I was attached to the get ahead in my career vine. It was a productive vine to be attached to until it wasn't. And honestly, looking back, I don't know that it gave me much joy. I got a little bit of an adrenaline high every time I got a promotion or a raise, but that didn't stay around. It wasn't a lasting joy. It wasn't a complete joy. It didn't show me an unconditional love with no strings attached. My job never called me friend or child. I never felt embraced. I often didn't even feel supported. Now, that's not to say y'all need to quit your jobs and become pastors, but that is to say, where are you attaching? Where's your time, your talent, your money, your energy? And does it bring you overflowing joy, complete joy to you that you share with others? That circle, that complete circle of love. And remember that word joy. That word joy is off the root word charis in Greek, which means grace. So what that means is joy is grace, forgiveness, love, and mercy. It's not happiness. It's not necessarily fun and excitement, but it is contentment and security and comfort. It's something that takes away your guilt. I say this all the time. There is no guilt and shame in Jesus, and this is why. Because of that grace. So today, that's the question I want you to think about. Is what vine am I attached to? Because what fruit am I producing that others are attracted to? Catherine's going to play a song. And I want you to meditate on that for a moment. I want you to ask yourself that hard question. If you're brave enough, you might not be. That's a hard thing to admit to yourself that you're attaching to the wrong vine. But I want you to ask yourself that question and then ask yourself what you need to do to move that attachment. Thank you. more story to tell you as our benediction. Usually stories are not a benediction, but I think this one can serve as one. Before I got the call to ministry, I know I wasn't abiding that well. I just started right before. And when God called me, many of you know, my first words were, "Are you sure? Do you know me?" And after God convinced me, he was sure. And he did know me way better than I did. The biggest hang up for me was I didn't really know too many female pastors. And the female pastors I knew were not people I really connected with. They didn't seem like me. And so that was a struggle for me. But God assured me we would be fine. Just walk with me, and I did. Fast forward a few years, a friend of mine who's a Baptist pastor at a independent, old-fashioned Baptist church that his father started, he came to me, he called me, he said, "Can we go to lunch? I got questions." Sure. So we went to lunch, and he said, "How do you convince people that it's okay for you to be a pastor?" And I said, "I don't. I've never tried to do that." Partly because in the beginning I wasn't so sure I was. And then as it went along, I just didn't. I found that when people are dead set against something, they're not going to hear you. And so I just didn't. And he said, "Well, what do you think makes it okay for the people who see you as a pastor to see you as a pastor?" And I said, "Well, why? Are you having a problem?" And he said, "Well, no," he said, "I've got two women at my church that are incredible teachers, and they would be so valuable to the whole church, but they're women." And I said, and he goes, "And I want to be able to convince people that it's okay." And I said, "Are these people in your church saying, is there a problem?" He's like, "No, they're all for it." And I was like, "Then who?" And it was other pastors in the community. And I said, "You know what? The first thing there is, that's none of their business. Second thing, here's the thing. Do they produce fruit that is good of Jesus?" And he said, "Yes." And I said, "That's always been my litmus test. I feel like if God called me to ministry and I produce fruit, I'm supposed to be here. If my ministry produces fruit, the day it stops producing fruit and I can't reconnect or I can't find a way to work with God, then that means my time is over as a pastor. And someone else needs to come along. Those women are still teaching in that church. There's a lot of people in that town that are not happy about it. But not at that church. You see, fruit of Jesus is powerful. Fruit of Jesus is attractive. And fruit of Jesus brings joy and grace and love. Have a blessed and holy week.